You are listening to the Hiking Radio Network, where we talk the walk with shows by hikers about hikers for everybody.
Welcome to the Trail Dames podcast, where we speak with women who love to dance upon this earth. Hey everyone, welcome to the Trail Dames podcast. We're so glad you're here. Today we're going to share with you one of our collection of stories from the trail, so sit back and join us as one of our favorite dames shares with you her story of hiking and dancing on the trail. My name is Anna Huthmaker. My friends all call me Mudbutt, and you are listening to the Trail Dames podcast.
This is Nancy East sharing one of her Trail Dame stories. Sit back and relax.
I'm gonna dance upon this earth.
So I was in Great Smoky Mountains National Park a couple of summers ago, and I was on one of my solo adventures, which just feeds my soul like no other. I was trying to finish my first map of the Smokies, which means I was trying to finish hiking all the trails in the park for the first time. I was closing in on the finish, but I had some pretty aggressive routes that I still needed to go and set out to do, and it required some backpacking, not just day hiking. So I set out from near the Cades Cove area, a late start. It was the middle of summer. My kids all needed to be shuttled to and from friends' houses and whatnot. So I didn't even get on the trail until about 2 p.m. in the afternoon and had about 17 hard miles to get to the campsite where I was going that night. Whenever I'm a solo backpacker, I always make sure to have a backup plan because I know that a lot of the backcountry sites will be full in the summer. It's peak season. And just in case there are any unsavory characters, as a woman, I always feel like it's prudent to have a plan B in case there are people that I'm just not comfortable being with in camp overnight. Luckily, that was not the case at all. I got into camp that night just about at dusk and had passed my plan B campsite, which was empty. So I thought, good. I've got a good solid plan B. But luckily, the five gentlemen who were in camp, we felt completely safe and comfortable with. It was two older gentlemen who had been coming to the same campsite for 30 years together, and then two brothers and a son, a teenage son. And they even fixed me dinner. They were very inquisitive about me being a solo female out on the trail, had lots of questions, but not really in a judgmental way, just a curious way. But as we talked over dinner, they told me about a bear who had been coming to the site all day long and about a rattlesnake who had been in camp as well and had, turns out that the son had been pestering the rattlesnake a bit, but it had struck at the son and did not strike him. But we had a little talk about maybe better etiquette around rattlesnakes to not have that happen. But anyway, the bear was what was concerning to me, knowing that here it is nighttime. By that point, it was dark. We're sitting around a campfire. It was too late for me to go to the Plan B campsite and feel a little bit safer, knowing this bear was probably going to come back around. But they were adamant that I would pitch my tent with their tent, near their tent, because they said, we'll be able to protect you better if this bear comes around. Well, their tent was surrounded by about five different coolers that they had brought into the backcountry. This was a site that backs up to Lake Fontana, so people can actually boat into it, and that's what happens quite a bit in this site. So therefore, they bring as much food and everything as they want to and just put it right there in the campsite. They don't hang it on these wonderful bear cables, and so you can imagine the bears just think, this is just a smorgasbord right in front of me every night. And that's exactly what was happening. So I politely declined, said I'm going to camp somewhere close by where I can, where you can hear me scream if he comes, you know, wanting to snack on me. But I think that I'm probably going to be in a better position. Well, that night, of course, the bear comes around. I hear in the middle of the night, a gunshot actually coming from the area. You have these three men that are camping with all the coolers, and I hear them hollering at this bear. They didn't shoot the bear, and they weren't intending to. They just shot a shot to scare him off, which it did. But of course, he kept coming back all night long, and this just kept continuing and cycling with this, the chaos, the noise. The bear would run off and then he would come back. So you can imagine, I didn't sleep a whole lot. I got up the next morning. They had made me breakfast again. They could not have been nicer. It was hard to know how to educate them because I knew that they probably already knew what they should be doing and just chose to ignore it and just having this big Wild West adventure probably in their minds. But later on that day, I was hiking back to my car and was up on the Appalachian Trail and came around a bend and had yet another bear encounter. This one was actually a little bit scarier than the first. A bear just didn't see me coming around the bend, and I spooked it. So it came charging at me and stopped short of me, probably about 10 feet, but took several years off my life, I'm sure, in the process. And I backed up, probably a half a mile just to give it space. It when it stopped, it did stop and just kind of stared straight into my soul. But then I removed myself from the situation and it left me alone. And I went through that area about 30 minutes later, singing at the top of my lungs. And I thought, if, you know, the noise doesn't scare it off, my singing voice is sure to. And I did not encounter the bear again, but I did get to my car after the end of this somewhat stressful backpacking trip when it was all said and done, and had a $50 parking ticket waiting on me. So the other lesson in this is make sure that you don't park in picnic areas overnight in the Smokies, which I was not aware of, because you will get fined and they are very quick to write that ticket. So lots of lessons learned in this trip. Make lots of noise as a solo hiker. Have those plan Bs, backup plans with backcountry sites, hang your food on those wonderful bear cables. And just know that even when you do everything right, sometimes things are still going to go awry and you just have to roll with it and deal with it as it comes. And that's my trail story.
Thank you so much for joining us for a Trail Dame story. If that's the kind of thing you enjoy, then make sure you go and subscribe to the Trail Dames podcast. You can find us anywhere that podcasts are gathered. And if you have any stories of your own you'd like to share, give us a call at info@traildames.com. We'd love to have you join us and share your story. My name is Anna Huffmaker. My friends all call me Mudbutt. And thank you for joining us on the Trail Dames podcast. My mother.